So I'd like to invite our previous boss, Dr. Muhammad Wahid Al-Shamri. And I really, really want to thank him because he was the pioneer who suggested that this work should be done. And he is the person who really started the outreach amputation prevention program. He's known to all of you.
Thank you, Muhammad. I told them in the beginning, I'm happy to see all these faces again, and I think we are doing a very unique work in this region. I'm not aware of any similar program in the Middle East, the whole Middle East, a combination of cooperating centers together to help save the patient. And we listened to Dr. Rayman Shishan, how the horrible numbers of diabetic and that patient in Saudi Arabia and the risk of the amputation, and we listened to the excellent presentation of Dr. Imran about the management, evaluation, and the surgical of the wound and the patient as a whole. And we also, Dr. Fida showed the imaging evaluation, and Dr. Rana showed the. I was given this task to talk about patient preparation, and actually, it's really nothing that I can educate you about, but it's really I'm going to reflect what we used to see, some problems we see from some patients that come from outside Riyadh, taking Faisal from the periphery, and I'm trying to just to discuss it with you. It's not really a very most of it. It's a basic thing. And now, sorry, what is the subject here? Now, I really ask all the doctors that when I talk to them that please send patient early, don't send late. We know all that this big wound and gangrene starts with a small injury. And in this small injury, many patients, not all of them, they will come to the ER, to the diabetic center, to the surgeon. And the more you refer them, the earlier you refer them, you prevent the late complication, the admission, the IV antibiotic, the cost, and you and the patient, and the burden, and then the poor outcome. And, multiple studies, I just was looking at the state study that, you could reduce the amputation rate significantly for these patients if you do them early in a multi-center, multi-disciplinary program and early referral. And this is a study I just said, this is their conclusion, They have lowered the amputation rate from 29 to 1%. And this is, limb salvage program, LSP, limb salvage, and increase with the endovascular option and the other wound care and infection control can help a lot of patients in your community. Not only this, your bed, you have limited beds, and then you can save them for real serious patients, whether it's general surgery or vascular cases. But these patients, many of them can be managed as an outpatient. You can do them as an outpatient. You can do them as angioplasty as an outpatient. They go for wound care. It can take weeks to heal, but also as an outpatient. So you help them, and you help yourself by early referral. And I know sometimes difficult because patients come to you late. The challenges they're not aware. Some patients in your hospital that you're not aware of them with other doctors. So it's a challenge. It's a daily challenge. But I think. Together we're doing, a good work, inshallah. Now, I'm going to tell you about the things that I have seen, witnessed, and here referred. What we request from each of you again, and most of you are doing this already, but I'm just reminded that we need the full history in the referral. When you write a paper, it's not just mentioned with CLI. You have to. Please help us. We categorize the patient which one to bring early. Basically aid and take to how the duration of the ulcer. Actually, you have patients here who came to us as and a CLI and they were asking them, he said, well, you know, doctor, it happens to me 2 weeks ago, I was sitting, suddenly I had this thing. It was an embolus. Now it became a gangrene, but it was an embolus. Now if we go and try to open this clot, we will shower everything. We can make him, you know, worse. You know, it's a small history. Listen, I know most of us busy, but really some basic history, basic medicine sometimes can change the whole management of the patient. And, you know, we discussed the patient are bedridden or, you know, I know the patient family have this, you know, social pressure to save the leg, the amputation, but you should think about the patient, not his family, most of the time. You tell them, I cannot save him, this leg is not useful, he has to go for amputation. And so sometimes you see patient very sick coming to us, you know, to discuss this even more. I know Dr. Firdaus talked about really good imaging, and we're trying, inshallah, to help, you know, the diabetic centers, 22 diabetic centers in Saudi Arabia, and maybe the imaging is not available, ultrasound, double result, I know it's operator dependent. Most hospitals are you know, they have few radiologists, they don't have time to do this. The non-invasive is the solution. It can be done by nurses, actually, and shown to the surgeon, to the endocrinologist, to general, and that can be really easily. Maybe they can help in this. I think this is a good direction to implement non-invasive imaging in the diabetic centers, not only for the wound, even for screening, and an annual screening with this patient. You can tell which patient is at risk. And this can maybe save a lot of burden and costs and amputation even, prevent amputation if we implement this. And it's, I think it's very easy to be taught to even nurses or non-doctors. Now, of course, you know, these patients are very sick. You know, they're and you know, we need to know if they have CABG before, they have renal impairment, and if they had, you know, hypertension, if they had bypass or angioplasty, these are all things that here in Faisal we need to know. And some patients, they're when they came to us, you know, it's socially, even if the government pays their tickets, their sons and daughters, they have to take off their work, and it's a social impact. Actually, I still remember when we had one patient come from Taif. I still remember him, actually. He came with his mother, high blood sugar. It was the first referral. It was very high. We couldn't do it. We told him to go to Bin Salman Hospital. And he never came back. And the Taif never referred any case. He even made the problem to us. Not a single case after that. So, because he was shouting with us, you know, I need to admit, we cannot admit King Faisal. King Faisal is very, if you go to the ER, King Faisal is very full. And there's no way you can admit patient for blood sugar control in King Faisal. Cannot do him. He just need to be controlled. So, if you know this is in warfarin that can be stopped, please stop it 5-6 days before the procedure. If his blood sugar is high, you know, work with your colleagues to control the blood sugar in him. Also, do labs. The CBC. If he has anemia, this anemia, many of them are anemic actually. And maybe need to be corrected, very low anemia. If he has infection, you know, white blood cells, he may want to start the antibiotics before he comes. You know, renal impairment, we're going to talk this about more. And you know, these are the standard labs we like to do. We do them here as well, but it will tell us if patient is you know, you might think maybe he has liver disease and he has high INR, we cannot do him. So these are simple tests that your nurse, your assistant can do them, you know, chest X-ray. We had one patient come for a pneumonia. He has really a solid pneumonia. He's febrile, but from pneumonia. But basic evaluation, ECG, and if you can do the ABI. These things I know you're most of them busy surgeons, busy doctors, but I think your team can manage this easily, you know, quick checklist and see them, and can help that the patient will come here and do a proper angioplasty and come back to you and for the follow-up, but not to be delayed or get in the hassle. Because again, here, even though it's coming from far away or something, but if he's not medically fit or has a problem, have a sugar infection or you know, other thing, we you know, what was in warfare, will not risk the patients. You know, talk about infection, you know, direct gangrene in the left side, you know, we can maybe some cellulitis. But when they have deep, we see patients who come with really, you know, abscess and you know, deep infection. This patient needs to be drained before. I know this is basic. I know it's basic, but really we see patients like this. And it actually can jeopardize the whole program. You know, we have the CEO of the hospital, Dr. Rashid, and the Queen Faisal is a tertiary care hospital. They're more of complex cases, cancer, you know, transplant, and so they actually, I had meeting with you know, with management. They told Mohammed, you know, you bring diabetic foot to my ER. I don't want to see diabetic foot in my ER. Otherwise, close the program. So you can help us maintain this program if we can prevent these incidences. This lecture is more political. They told, don't send infected patient to us unless he's been treated. He's met sometimes with if he's an inpatient, you can bring him to ambulance and bring him. You have to tell the patient, King Faisal doesn't accept diabetic foot. We will not accept diabetic foot here because they cannot. But they will help provide the endovascular procedure for you, and you know, to help you save your leg from amputation, and you'll continue your medication and treatment in your hospital, in your town, close to your family, your you know. So because many of they have this thing, you know, when I'm accepted the King Faisal, I have five King Faisal, and accept me, they show up to the ER. And then we have problem with the ER, we have problem, and this can shut the whole program. This whole thing, you know, fortunately we have few cases, we showed them our numbers, we have more than 1,000 cases, we have two or three shown to the ER, 12 illnesses, you know. And and patients have trouble sending them to the patient to leave the ER and go for the hospital or another hospital for the infection control. I'm here, you know, it's a mentality. So, you know, please help us in this. And it's, I don't know, Mohammed, if you, but Badran's here, you want to come, you had also a certain comment in this, because this is a...
I want to thank you very much. Also, after Mohammed left, the management also called me. They told me, you know, you're bringing patients with infected and we don't have beds. Vascular surgery also have a very small number of beds in the hospital. I want to tell you that over the last 2 years, we did more than 1,000 cases. Alhamdulillah, only probably 10 of these required admissions. But even those 10 patients, the hospital is causing a problem, and they threaten that if you don't behave, we will not cooperate. So far, you know, Dr. Rashid, he came and he is really supportive. Dr. Mufadda is supportive, our chairman of the department is supportive, vascular surgery are supportive, everybody is supportive. But there is a limit because they don't want to jeopardize the rest of the hospital care. So please help us in controlling the infection. We suggested the limit of YSIL count of 11,000. I know Dr. Massar is protesting because maybe 11,000 is the upper limit of normal. But the reason for this is not really to stop the referrals when there is a little bit of infection, but to raise the awareness that we need to do something about it before the patient come in. Because what happens sometimes also, the patient is okay. He has infection, he's okay. But there's no blood supply to the infection. Once we open up the artery, all the blood will go to the infected area, carry all the bacteria, and then the patient ends with septic shock, and this happened to us in the hospital. And then we are blamed by the hospital, and they really need to stay for a long time in the hospital, mainly under Faris and his colleagues.
So, the key is that let's work together. Sometimes I know, and most of these, cannot, you know, you're a busy surgeon, you're a busy doctor, your colleagues, your nursing, you can have a checklist with you. Let's check the CBC, let's check the, you know, blood sugar, let's check the renal profile. And, you know, we can manage things together. You know, he has blood, says we started the antibiotics, we took a swab culture, he's identified the bacteria, you know, he started the antibiotics already, he's been covered, we are aware, we can still work together, because he will need the revascularization quickly as well. We're not going to delay his revascularization, but he's already been managed. He's already aware. Father Dr. Amir.
I have one suggestion. It's saying that some patients are giving appointment after, for example, 10 days. During those 10 days, his condition is changing. So my suggestion is that you think, when they are giving the appointment, tell him go back to your referral doctor and do those checklists for 2 or 3 days. So he's coming with those the investigation 2-3 days before he is coming here. This is a better way. Otherwise, we refer the patient. He will come after 2 weeks. His condition is changed, and this is
the challenge, Dr. Amir. You know, sometimes
yes,
we were supposed here first to open the new tower. It's going to open soon. The reason we're going to expand here with the work, Shabab Kamilun, they will expand the work, and this 10 days, inshallah, will be reduced as well. Lakino, still, Doctor, the initial presentation, you saw him, let your nurse order these labs. Have her come back after two days. See that while waiting for acceptance the referral, you see him, you can manage him, you can start the antibiotics, you can control his blood sugar, you can, you know, see his if he's in warfarin or INR is high, you can see why. And then these, not only but just accepting because patients, but also Dr. Amir, they come all this way from Tabuk or from, you know, Hail or Grayat, and then you discover that, and you told them, sorry, I cannot do it, we have to come after 4 days. It's a very big social problem for them. And I'm telling, sometimes you cannot prevent it. Sometimes, just even with this, you'll have people who suffer, but you can reduce significant number of this suffering by cooperating with this.
If I may add something also, I think really it's the expectations of the patients, because they, as soon as they receive a word from King Faisal, whether it's right or wrong, they feel that this is the place where I'm going to get everything managed. I have people who I accept for, let's say, an aortic aneurysm, and they tell me I also have sciatica and I want referral for. So it's not particular only to this care. So I think from the beginning, if they could be told that this is a limited eligibility, it's not an eligibility for full access to care, it's an eligibility for angioplasty, for example, at least they come prepared from beginning, because a lot of them come with their whole family ready for the admission. They come for the angioplasty and immediately to the ER after half an hour. So
we are under pressure here, Shabab. We are pressured by the hospital here. They say this is a tertiary care cancer center, transplant center. Diabetic foot is not a tertiary care. It can be managed everywhere. And if they come to the ER, or ER, we're going to just close this program, no more help. And we tried to see with this, see with more than 1,000 cases, and it's your, alhamdulillah, we're a success. We're a success. But we're trying to, these small numbers of cases with small things, we can help them. Some patients, they come to you very sick. Sometimes and we did this, and they come with ambulance from Qasim, from, you know, from Ibn Hail. They come in ambulance and we do the angioplasty and they go back. We do this in a certain number of cases. Lakin, we're trying to reduce these small one unnecessary ones. Yeah. And if patients are told, they can accept this. Even for other, if they accept it for neurosurgery, tumor, they know they will not be able to see the nephrologist here because they need a new referral. Lakin, alhamdulillah, so far I'm just saying things, basic things, that maybe you can create with Saad a checklist that you can do in your clinic checklist, and just see them, check them, patients come with high blood sugar, very high blood sugar. You know, you can correct it. It's actually your colleague in the diabetic center can change his medication. Or high blood pressure, we have patients with very high blood pressure. Actually, many times we have patients with very, he's nobody checks his blood pressure before. He's very hypertensive. It's very risky. I'm doing an elective procedure. It's not emergency. Why should I do him now? And I cannot manage his blood pressure. I'm a radiologist. He needs to see a physician. So these things, they can check it and check record blood pressure in your clinic and things. You will help them. And they will come and they will be fit for the procedure. They will do the good procedure and they come back, inshallah. Just to carry on. Now, with renal impairment, there are protocols for hydration and that. None of them is practical, but here what we do in King Faisal, we do is it working? We do the CO2, maybe most of you saw this, the gas CO2, and you could do, is it upside down? I'm sorry, it's reversed. Interesting. But the CO2, I'm sorry for the image, it's reversed. We have this gas, it's CO2, is gets absorbed in the blood, it's non-harmful, doesn't embolize, and it gives us good imaging, and we are very liberal here in using it. And if we use the contrast, you have the very limited contrast, you know, the nephrotoxicity of contrast is related to also the dose. So for a regular angiograph, for example, maybe use 70 to 100 cc of contrast, but in the digestive environment, we do combine CO2 and little contrast, we end up by using even 6 or 7, less than 10 cc. So we see, and with little hydration. So doesn't really bother us much, the renal impairment. But we just need to be aware of the renal impairment issue. Now, anticoagulation, most cases, you know, the aspirin, Glavix, and even Abscema, you didn't, for low-risk patients, you didn't need to stop, or warfarin, you need to stop. And we continue giving them for give the prescription and for to take it afterwards, not a major issue, and that's it. Alhamdulillah, I have nothing to add. But I'm saying, helping us doing the procedure, most patients we can avoid the small things that prevent the patients from doing the angioplasty. Thank you very much.
I just want to ask if you any points we would like to raise, any questions.
Please, it's a workshop.
Thank you very much, Mohammed, for inviting. We are really happy to have this invitation. You raised the point about the infection which you are facing sometimes. My position this phase, when I have a presentation in Ras Hospital last week, for example, I found that some general surgeon still they are not aware which is first, which. Should we clear infection or should we revascularize? He's keen about that he might amputate without a vascularized bed. So these issues are very important. My concern is that if we meet as a vascular surgeon and interventionist and we are lagging behind the other pillars, which is the general surgeons and the physiotherapist, for example, internist. My suggestion is that this program is a multidisciplinary and everyone should be responsible. General surgeon, till now, they hate diabetic foods. When any of the consultants call and they receive diabetic foods, most of them, they feel that this is like something a burden. They don't have the feeling of enjoying and saving or salvaging a limb. So the whole philosophy has to be changed. For our center, for example, I'm talking about our place. I'm trying to change this idea that saving a limb is equal like, for example, thousands of laparoscopic mastectomy because you are saving an infrastructure, the whole society. So my suggestion in these items, general surgeons should be aware, should be always involved in the food, diabetic food management. We should have guidelines, established guidelines. Even sometimes when you kindly revascularize a limb, some people, they don't know, okay, let us, when I should amputate. Most of them, they are not aware that it's what's called shock vessels, which need to build after angioplasty by 3 weeks like that, which build more, enough vascular bed for healing. So this is need to be transmitted to the media. I share you the feeling that King Faisal should not stuck with, for example, not only infected patients. Dialysis was overload, dialysis was high potassium. We understand the dilemma. But it's really, I feel, it is, so long it's a national project, everybody should take the responsibility.
Who's care? This is not only here, it's not unique for us, it's even global actually, this collaboration. See that, these poor patients, nobody's interested in it, the general surgeons or other, you know, it's not appealing because, you know, at the end, they're going to lose a toe or a leg. It's not like morbid obesity they can do, or, you know, alcohol, you can do this. It's not appealing, and so this is one thing. The other thing is very difficult to have multidisciplinary, unfortunately, specialty care of this. And the MOH, we hope MOH have to be a leader in this and developing guidelines. But so far we're working together and hoping for, you know, everybody to cooperate. Now the dilemma went to whether to drainage first or endovascular first. This is always a dilemma. In most cases, you have to open and take the bus out. but then you're stuck, you need the Vaseline. How can I transfer a vegetable to an inpatient? It's a dilemma, we know that. But we, in certain cases, we can work with you. If you call us here, we can bring base by ambulance, do the angioplasty, and then back to you if he's impatient and he needs revascularization. I don't know, Faris, if you want to comment on this.
I think it depends on the clinical situation. There are multiple indications for urgent amputation or debridement, which clearly, if your facilities for angioplasty are not immediate, you have to do that first to save the patient. I think there is some, what you're alluding to, some people, they would do the debridement and then they would want to wait a month or so before doing angioplasty. Yeah. Personally, I don't agree with that. I think the first thing is the infection, but you should not delay the revascularization process, in my opinion.
No, I'm sorry, I'm not talking about delaying the revascularization. Okay, delaying the amputation. For example, if you have a dry gangrene and might be infected and you want to plan for amputation and you are worried about that after amputation the bed will not heal. So after angioplasty, I mean that rushing the amputation immediately after angioplasty, still you have a chance of non-healed wound. But when you give a chance for the bilaterals to build up, the chance is better.
I think if you don't have infection,
then
in that case you could wait 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks. There is no rush to do the amputation. In some cases, you even leave it to auto-amputate.
But I think the idea is having some sort of collaboration with the Ministry of Health to educate the general surgeons. I think that's a very good idea. The other thing which I want to also mention is acute limb ischemia. Now, acute limb ischemia is a different ballgame because, alhamdulillah, most of the acute limb ischemia is rare. It's not a common disease. But when you have acute limb ischemia, the most cases is either sudden thrombosis of a stenosis or an embolic phenomenon. And most of these patients, unfortunately, they require admission. And although we would want to help, and I'm sure that we're vascular surgeon to help, and we can discuss individual cases, but we will be also facing difficulty with hospital because they require admission. So far, our selling point with the hospital is that we are doing this as outpatient. Once we got to acute limb ischemia, what I have been doing now is I'm discussing it with our vascular colleagues because most likely they will need admission. So maybe at the beginning, if they can be admitted at your hospital, you give them heavy, good anticoagulation, heparin IV, and so on, until we figure out what to do. But until now, really, the hospital is refusing to bring acute limb ischemia.
Actually, they can't. And if you go to the ER, I took my son the other week to the ER. He has pneumonia. He's 4 years old child. People in the in the emergency in the corridors. And you remember, in the case there are more than 1,200 beds something. But all Saudi Arabia want to treat with the King Faisal. They cannot. Yeah, it's just and it's full. The hospital is full. This is the problem.
I just want to say. Dr. Shamdari and Badran are raising this not because we want to be more cautious about what's happening. We are very happy with, I would say, 95% of referrals. There's no issue. The few cases that we face with acute thrombosis and infection, we are more than happy to discuss with you what's the protocol to deal with these patients.
Brainstorming, you mean?
Yeah, I mean, because at the end of the day, we have a huge interest to make this program more successful. We don't want to go back to the number. In fact, we want to increase the numbers. But we need your help in putting certain protocols to avoid these embarrassing moments with the administration. What Dr. Amir was suggesting is a very valid point. If there is a long period between the admission, between the referral and the appointment, we have to agree on specific time of examination, blood tests, to be sent to us even before the patient comes, and then we agree immediately in 3 days that, okay, the patient can forward. We are open for these ideas. We want to feel that we are one team in this. We face together certain challenges, and we solve them together. This is the aim of raising this.
There is a big team. You know how social media is, SF sometimes, it's bad. One patient, if you refuse him, you send me 300 patients, and one patient you send them to me, and I refuse it because he's not fit or something, or somebody slipped. He will make a big trouble. these guys, Dr. Amir, send me these cases and they confess as bad. And unfortunately, this can happen, and can destroy the whole reputation. What I'm saying, sometimes you cannot prevent this. These things happen. But if it's preventable, I tell you, Allah, this Taif, I still remember this old lady from Taif. I still remember zero referral from Taif since then. Zero. She came with high blood sugar, very high blood sugar. I told him, please go. But I'm here to confess. And then he refused, and the doctor was there upset. He made trouble to the doctor, and they stopped referring because they say, well, why would we do a headache for us? I'm saying for small things, if we can manage it and prevent it, that would be better, inshallah.
I think to add to Dr. Shamri's point, if you have any hesitation about the diagnosis or the need for surgical intervention and admission, etc., don't hesitate to call us.
Yeah, don't
wait for the referral letter, etc. Because always verbally we can get more understanding of what's going on, either IR or ourselves, we're happy to take a call.
And even the timing for management, which one's first? We can discuss it with each other. Should we do the plasty first and you do in 2 times or 2 days or a week the amputation or vice versa? So we can move towards just referral to discussing each patient alone and how we can manage together. Because we find sometimes, as Dr. Farid said, sometimes we do the intervention and then the patient, for a reason or another, maybe disappear, will come back later after 3-4 months and he didn't have any debridement at all. So meanwhile, the artery is closed and we have to do him again and he's in worse situation. So sometimes really we need to discuss patient per patient and what is the timing for each step in the management from our side and your side to get the best
possible to have a communication with you all the time.
Not me, no, I mean all the time. Yes, we are open for this.
Because we have one case, sorry, Sam.
That's fine, I have to leave.
Well, I sent one photo complete occlusion, common iliac artery, and we discussed with the brother Saad and doctor. And the family, they refused to do anything in North Nara Hospital. They entrusted King Faisal. I said that, but I did not receive any answer to refer or not to refer. Then I done for patient surgery. Patient female, Saudi, 70 years. Coronary artery disease, atrial fibrillation, short stroke, severe wrist pain. So they interested the King Faisal. Here we did not receive answer, and there is no. I am eating the brain of Brother Saad. He is the one who is answering. The difficult communication with other doctors.
The other thing, do you receive the patient with our reports? We send them reports. Do they come to you?
Yes, already solved this problem.
Not all of our patients.
They didn't come back to you?
Yes, some of them, they are coming back with even with the team. Others, without paper, without CD, just verbally, I went there.
We have to look at this because now it should be everyone doesn't leave the department without. If there is an issue with specific case, we have to look at it.
Inshallah.
Thank you for your invitation to this informative workshop. As regards to meaning, it's a solution. We have an idea about communication, about feedback, about to initiate a website for this program. We can submit a case after complete investigation, after seeing the web, and we take a decision after the evaluation, and you give me a feedback on the web. Write down or copy admission decision for the patient. Later on, you can send me a report on the same. So it will be easy idea to facilitate a communication between each other. We try this idea in insulin pump program.
Uh-huh.
It facilitates
Okay.
Video communication.
Why not? Wallah,
it's a good idea, but we need to see if the hospital.
Exactly.
Of course, the hospital should accept this. May I suggest that
these. No, they're patient, not our patient. They're patient.
Yeah. Oh.
May I suggest this to be in the session? It will be about.
Okay, challenges.
One more point, if you allow me to come. Maybe it's the chance to reinvent again in our video conference,
yes.
Meeting weekly, which we used to do for a certain time until last year, which is dedicated just to discuss those cases and then is what we have done, what we'd like you to do. Okay. Yeah. So we used to do those video conferences to discuss each single case which we did to
Even over if you don't have a video conference system, you can do it with us with your mobile. We have a good system that can access yourself anywhere, even from your home. We can send you a link and you can communicate with us. Encourage you. Even if you are not
regular.
For example, if you are from the Majma'a, from anywhere, we can still communicate.
Like this previously with Dr. Mohammed Shamari many times.
Or something like that. You are going to use our hub, which is private, which is no doubt of any interference or anything there.
كان المشكلة قبل because different doctors have different OR days yes, and it's difficult to come on all of them in one day. Yes. We had problems يعني and we're also busy here شباب busy what to do مرة الصبح مرة in afternoon so that's the problem the time maybe in, I don't know in the solutions or technology why not
another program like the fetal therapy program other programs we have for example, put Sunday and Monday from 1 to 2:30, for example. This is anyone wants to communicate with us,
yes.
They can communicate. So that yes. We have, it's not the urgent case, but they want to discuss. And we can do this also.
Why not?
Even
this
though
is a very
we
good
have,
idea.
Even though we have another solution, which is virtual training. You can also, virtual training here, you can start communicate Ms. Bedawiya or Sa'ad. And he can communicate with you.
Yeah. And I want to thank you all. We will move to the next two parts.